Every person in our world is heading toward eternal life or eternal death. Bible prophecy tells us we are living in the last days of Earth's history, when every person's eternal destiny is to be decided. The purpose of Steps to Life Television is to help you make the decisions you must make if your destiny is to be eternal life.
I was riding back to the mortuary from the cemetery with the funeral director. We were talking about the end of the world. He said to me, "I believe that the world is going to end, but it could be many years in the future. Although we don't know when the world will end, is there a way to tell when the end of the world is drawing near?" There is, according to Bible prophecy. Before we look at some of those Bible prophecies, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to study. Father in heaven, as we now look at Bible prophecy about the signs of the times in which we're living, we humbly but earnestly pray that your Holy Spirit will teach us the truth and give us a heart to obey and follow our Master who has redeemed us from sin. We pray in his name. Amen.
We'd like to send you a free booklet entitled Avalanche of Violence. To receive your free gift, simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for Offer AV. We're living in a world filled with violence, and it is increasing more with each passing year. What are the root causes of this global problem? Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH to request your free book. And now, Pastor John Grosbaugh.
Jesus told his disciples in Matthew 24 that there was nobody that knew exactly when the world as we know it would end. In fact, Jesus said, even the angels of heaven do not know this. But although we do not know exactly when the world will end, there are many Bible prophecies that tell us when we are drawing near to the end of the world. Let's just look at a few. In the book of Revelation, the 11th chapter, we read this in verse 18. It says, "The nations were angry." The nations were angry. Have you heard of any nations that are angry? We're living in a world where nations are angry. They're angry with each other. That statement is so up to date that you could read it in the newspaper. In the very last days, the nations are going to be angry. You see it all over the world today. That's why there's so many people fleeing. That's why there's so many refugees. But what is it in the very last days that is associated with this anger of the nations? What is that a sign of when the nations are all angry with one another? Well, notice as we continue reading in the verse, it says, "The nations were angry, and your wrath has come." There's coming a time when not only will the nations be angry, but God is going to say, it is time that my wrath is going to be poured out in this world because of its wickedness. There are many prophecies in the Old Testament declaring this fact, that the time is going to come when the wrath of God will be poured out upon this world because of the wickedness of this world. But that's not all. That's not all. If we go down to the rest of the verse, notice what it says. "The nations were angry, your wrath has come, and the time of the dead that they should be judged." So this is a time of the judgment. And we know from other Bible prophecies that the judgment occurs at the end of the world. It says, "And that you should reward your servants, the prophets, and the saints, and those who fear your name, small and great." For thousands of years, God's children have been waiting for the Lord to intervene in the affairs of this world and to bring salvation and bring the human race back to paradise. We read in the 11th chapter of Hebrews about Abraham and his descendants. And this is what it says about them. It says, these all died in faith, not having received the promises. They had received promises, but they had not received the fulfillment of the promises. Having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. And truly, if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return. But now they desire a better, that is, a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for He has prepared a city for them. This prophecy in Revelation 11, 18 predicts the time when the Lord says, it's time now. Those that have served me down through the ages are now going to receive their reward. But that's not all. Now we come clear to the end of the verse. That those who fear your name, small and great, they should be rewarded, and that you should destroy those who destroy the earth. Now, that is a very interesting statement. It says that at the end of the world, when God's wrath has come, that He is going to destroy the people who are destroying the earth. Now, in previous ages, if you study history, we did not have the capability. The human race did not have the capability to destroy the earth. But during the 20th century, we developed that capability. We have the ability today. In fact, we have the chemicals, the weapons, or more than one nation has them. We have enough weapons that if we started to use them, we could destroy everything in every living creature in the earth. That is a fulfillment of Bible prophecy. According to Bible prophecy, at the end of the world, there will be people in this world, nations, individuals, groups of people, who will be destroying the earth. There's more than one way, by the way, to destroy the earth. We have several ways to do it today. But the Lord says, when He comes, I'm going to destroy those that are destroying the earth. About 150 years ago, there lived in Paris a French scientist. He was a very wise man. I don't know if I can, I'm not good at pronouncing French words. I don't know if I can pronounce his name or not. Borchardt is the closest I would come. And this is what he said. Within 100 years, man will discover the secret of the atom. Interestingly, 100 years after he spoke, we had discovered the secret of the atom. He said, man will develop atomic power. That's exactly what happened. But that was just the first part of a prophecy that he made. This is what he said after that. He said, when man has discovered atomic power, God will come down and say, gentlemen, turn in your keys. It's closing time. So, we have discovered atomic power today, and it's interesting when you look at recent history, ever since atomic power has been developed, thinking men and women around the world have looked at this and associated the development of atomic power with the end of the world. After the atomic bombs were dropped on Hiroshima, as some say, and Nagasaki, General Douglas MacArthur said, we must find some other way to solve our world problems because if we don't, Armageddon will be at our door. Well, what is the international situation like today? It is ironic, paradoxical, what we find. We find when we look at the international situation that all there are tremendous movements to initiate world peace. This has been going on for over 100 years. And at the same time that there are tremendous movements on foot to initiate a lasting and a world peace, At the same time, there is unprecedented preparedness for war. Did you know that over 2,000 years ago, the Bible predicted that this is exactly what would happen in the last days? Let me read it to you. Look what it says in the book of Isaiah, chapter 2. Isaiah chapter 2, we'll read verses 2 to 4. Now it shall come to pass in the last days, the latter days, that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established on the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations shall flow to it. Many people shall come and say, Come, and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us His ways. We shall walk in His paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations. Now, this is what many people will say. He shall judge between the nations and shall rebuke many people. They shall beat their swords into plowshares. You don't need swords anymore. Created into something peaceful. Their spears into pruning hooks. Don't need swords anymore. We beat them into plowshares. We don't need spears anymore. We beat them into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation. Neither shall they learn war anymore. It says that's what many people are going to say in the last days. That's what we've been saying in the world for over 100 years. But when many people are saying this, they're saying we're going to beat our swords into plowshares. We're going to beat our spears into pruning hooks. Let's read what the Bible says that God says. At this very same time, we look in the book of Joel. Joel, the third chapter. And this is the Lord speaking. And this is what the Lord says, starting in the verse 9. Proclaim this among the nations. Prepare for war. Wake up the mighty men. Let all the men of war draw near. Let them come up. Beat your plowshares into swords. Notice it's just the opposite. The people are saying, beat your swords into plowshares. The Lord says, beat your plowshares into swords. The people say, we're going to beat their spears into pruning hooks. But the Lord says, beat your pruning hooks into spears. Just the opposite. Let the weak say, I am strong. Assemble and come, all you nations, and gather together all around. Cause your mighty ones to go down there, O Lord. Let the nations be wakened, and come up to the valley of Jehoshaphat. For there I will sit to judge all the surrounding nations. Put in the sickle, for the harvest is ripe. For the winepress is full, the vats overflow, for their wickedness is great. That's the trouble, by the way, all through Bible prophecy. It's predicted that at the end of the world is going to become more wicked than ever before. It's here. It's in Jesus talked about it. It's in the New and Old Testament. It's all through the Bible. It says, multitudes, multitudes in the valley of decision. For the day of the Lord is near in the valley of decision. So, there's going to be an international religious peace movement, as we read in Isaiah, the second chapter. But at the same time, what's really going to be happening is nations are going to be preparing like never before for war. We see exactly today what the Bible predicted was going to happen in the last days. Jesus Christ made a most positive declaration about when the end of the world would come. He said in Matthew 24:14, this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness for all nations, and then shall the end come. Is the gospel of the kingdom, the good news of our Lord's return, being preached all over the world today? You have the answer in the great Second Advent movement. millions of people who are preaching the message of Revelation 14, 6 to 12, which is to prepare the way for the return of Christ and the second advent. Just as John the Baptist preached a preparatory message to prepare the way for the first advent. Now, in the last several minutes, we've only covered just a few of the signs given in the Bible that the world is at the end stage of its development and is coming to an end soon. However, I want you to see that there are many, many Bible prophecies that predict what we see happening in the world today. And so, we're going to go over about 30 or so. In just a moment, we're going to go over about 30 different Bible prophecies that show us that we're living in the end time.
Bible prophecy has accurately predicted the future of churches and nations hundreds and thousands of years in advance. Bible prophecy is the only dependable guide to what is really going to happen in the future and how to get ready for it. The Steps to Life Bible Correspondence Course lessons will help you understand Bible prophecy and Bible teaching about how you can be ready for the future. These lessons can be sent to your home without cost to you, or you can study the lessons online. Call 1-800-THE-TRUTH to enroll, or log on to our website at www.stepstolife.org.
Welcome back. In Luke 21, Jesus gave a number of signs that would occur just before the end of the world. This is what he says was going to happen. Now he's not talking about days or months before the end of the world. He's talking about the last generation, a number of years before the end of the world. This is going to happen. Notice what he says. There will be great earthquakes in various places. Study for yourself and see how the number of earthquakes has increased. I was looking at an encyclopedia, and it listed the number of serious earthquakes. We're not talking about minor earthquakes. There are so many you can't even count them anymore. But the number of serious earthquakes, some people said, well, they didn't know when the earthquakes were happening before we had the seismograph and all these things. But wait a minute. If there's an earthquake that's big enough so that buildings start falling down, that gets taken note of and people record it, and it's in the history books. And in this encyclopedia, I noticed that there had been the same number of serious earthquakes, major earthquakes, between 1980 and 1990 as there was between 526 and 1797, a period of about 1,300 years. Has there been an increase of earthquakes all over the world? There's an increase of earthquake. This is a sign of the times. Jesus said there would be earthquakes, great earthquakes, in various places. And then he said there would be famines. Famines. Never has the world been more threatened by famines than in the last generation, during the last 100 years. And then Jesus said a third thing he said was what would happen is that there would be pestilences. Pestilences. Do you know what a pestilence is? Here's a dictionary definition of a pestilence. A pestilence is a contagious or infectious epidemic that is virulent and devastating. A pestilence is a contagious or infectious epidemic that is virulent or devastating. Are we having that in the world today? We're having exactly what Jesus said would happen in the very last days. Great earthquakes, famines, and pestilences. Virulent, infectious disease that is in an epidemic level. There will be great earthquakes in various places and famines and pestilences, and there will be fearful sights and great signs from heaven. That's Luke 21:11. There will be destruction even in the animal world by insects. It's predicted in the first chapter of Joel. And then in the business world, the Bible predicts that in the last days there would be a rapid accumulation of wealth. There are more extremely wealthy people today than there has ever been in the history of the world. More than there, way more than there was 40 or 50 years ago. been a rapid accumulation of wealth. It says that in James, the fifth chapter. And also, there would be swift means of travel. A couple hundred years ago, the average man was born, lived, grew up, and died in a relatively small area because travel was by horse or eventually by steamship or railroad. But today, in less time than it took people to go across the country in those days, a person can travel around the world. And then, of course, the Bible says that in the last days there's going to be trouble with labor. You can read about that in James, the fifth chapter, verses 1 to 6. And also in the last days, the Bible predicts that there's going to be an increase in knowledge. An increase of knowledge and rapid travel. You can read that in Daniel 12, verse 4. In the political world, the Bible predicts that in the last days there will be a speeding up of events. That's mentioned several different places. One place is in Isaiah 17. And then Jesus said, there's going to be fear and distress and perplexity everywhere. Jesus said it would be so bad that men's hearts would fail them for fear. In 1955, when President Dwight D. Eisenhower had a heart attack, his personal physician, Paul Dudley White, made this interesting statement. Now remember, Paul Dudley White was a cardiologist. He was a physician who specialized in treatment of the heart. He graduated from medical school in 1921. He said that he did not see his first heart attack patient until 1928. Notice, he had been a physician for 7 years before he saw his first heart attack. It's not that way today. I've seen more than one, and I'm not a physician. Well, what's the difference? Well, what Jesus said was going to happen in the very last days, we have seen it happen in our generation. That's Luke 21, 25, and 26. We already read the prophecy that there would be all-out preparation for war, but there would be an international religious peace movement among the nations. There would be racial hatred. There would be trouble and uprisings throughout the world in the last days, Jesus said. That's in Luke 21. In the last days, there was going to be great corruption in government. You can read that in several places. One example would be the little book, the prophetic book of Micah. There would also be disregard for justice in the last days. There would be increasing pressure for religious legislation in the last days. You can read about that in Revelation 13. And there would be growing prestige for hierarchical church government in the last days. Well, how about the social world? In the social world, in the last days, there was going to be a moral breakdown. There are many texts of Scripture to substantiate this. Jesus said in the last days that lawlessness would abound. People would be not law-abiding, but they would be lawless. It would be abounding so much so, he said, that the love of many would become cold. And then in the last days, according to Matthew 24, there was going to be a great increase in crime. At the same time, in the last days, there was going to be a craze for pleasure. At the same time, in the last days, there's going to be laxity in the marriage relation. In other words, a perversion of the marriage relation. And in the last days, there was going to be a tide, an overwhelming tide of immorality throughout the world. And widespread travel. Are all those social problems evident in the world today? And then finally, in the religious world. In the last days, there was going to be a decline of real spirituality. You can find that predicted in 2 Timothy 3. In the last days, there was going to be a general disregard of the Ten Commandments. You can read that in several places, especially Revelation 12 and 13. In the last days, there would be widespread scoffing against the message of the nearness of the coming of Christ. People would make fun of it, say it wasn't so. You can read about that in 2 Peter 3. In the last days, there was going to be a rebellion against the straight truth of God's Word. You can read that in 2 Timothy 4. In the last days, there was going to be a demand for preachers to preach smooth things. You can read that many places. 1 and 2 Timothy. And also, there's going to be a demand for a prevalence of false religion. There would be a restoration also of neglected truth in the last days, according to Isaiah 58. There would be a widespread turning to spiritualism or spiritism in the last days. There would be a worldwide movement for proclaiming the message of Christ's soon return in the last days, according to Revelation 14. And there would be a calling out by this movement, a message. There would be calling out of God's remnant who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus, as you read in Revelation 12:17 and Revelation 14:12. Do you see all of these things happening in the world today? Approximately 30 different prophecies in the Bible, all coming to pass during our time, especially during the last 100 years. My dear friends, we're living in the closing, ending period of Earth's history. And when the end comes, there may be many lodges, many societies, many unions, many religions in the world today, but when the end comes, there will only be two classes of people. There'll be those that are ready and those that are not ready, those that are saved and those that are lost. My dear friend, there are only two destinies. Every one of us, you and me, we are all going to go to one of the two destinies that is available to the human race. And the book of Revelation makes this abundantly clear. When the end of the world comes, every person is going to end up either in hellfire or in heaven. There's no second choice. There's no third choice. There's no other place to go. Where are you going to go? It's determined by what you decide to do with Jesus Christ, whether you decide to accept Him as your Lord and Savior.
We all face one of two different destinies, eternal life or eternal death. We want to help you take the necessary steps so that your destiny will be eternal life. We worship the God who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days and rested on the Sabbath. You're invited to worship with us every Sabbath at 11 a.m. Central Time at our chapel at 9330 East Prairie Meadows Circle, Derby, Kansas, on Webb Road, 1/2 mile south of 47th Street, or online at www.stepstolife.org.
Today's free booklet is entitled Avalanche of Violence. To receive your free copy, simply call 1-800-THE-TRUTH and ask for Offer AV. Before the earth was destroyed by the flood, the Bible tells us in Genesis 6:11 that the earth was filled with violence. It also tells us that as the days of Noah were, so it will be in the days of the Son of Man. We are nearing the close of this earth's history, when this world will once again be cleansed. All violence will come to an end. Where will you be in that day? Will you be participating in the violence, or will you have made the decision to be separated from it? To receive your free copy of Avalanche of Violence, call 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788 and ask for Offer AV. Call now.
We hope you are choosing life as your eternal destiny. Steps to Life exists to help people choose life instead of death. We would love to hear from you. You can join us for worship on Saturdays at 11 a.m. Central Time at 9330 East Prairie Meadows Circle, Derby, Kansas, or write to Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278, or call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788, or email us at historic@stepstolife.org. Our web address is www.stepstolife.org.